"Livy," he said, "it would pain me to think that when I swear it sounds like that. You got the words right, Livy, but you don't know the tune." Yet he never willingly gave her pain, and he adored her and gloried in her dominion his life long. Howells speaks of his beautiful and tender loyalty to her as the most moving quality of his most faithful soul. It was a greater part of him than the love of most men for their wives, and she merited all the worship he could give her, all the devotion, all the implicit obedience, by her surpassing force and beauty of character. She guarded his work sacredly, and reviewing the manuscripts which he was induced to discard, and certain edited manuscripts, one gets a partial idea of what the reading world owes to Olivia Clemens. Of the discarded manuscripts, he seems seldom to have destroyed them. There are a multitude, and among them all, scarcely one that is not proof of her sanity and high regard for his literary honor. They are amusing, some of them. They are interesting, some of them. They are strong and virile, some of them. But they are unworthy, most of them, though a number remain unfinished because theme or interest failed. Mark Twain was likely to write not wisely, but too much, piling up hundreds of manuscript pages only because his brain was thronging as with a myriad of fireflies, a swarm of darting, flashing ideas demanding release. As often as not, he began writing with only a nebulous idea of what he proposed to do. He would start with a few characters and situations, trusting in Providence to supply material as needed. So he was likely to run ashore any time. As for those other attempts, stories unavailable for one reason or another, he was just as apt to begin those as the better sort, for somehow he could never tell the difference. That is one of the hallmarks of genius, the thing which sharply differentiates genius from talent. Genius is likely to rate a literary disaster as its best work. Talent rarely makes that mistake.